Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 29 of the Stogie Geeks Show. I'm your host, Paul Asadorian, who's very sad that his team lost today. Though I'm still adorning the jersey because I will forever be a New England Patriots fan, even though they embarrassed me today. I think it's the best way to put it. Tim Mugherini is here on the lines via Skype. Welcome, Tim.
How's everybody doing?
I'm doing doing better now that I'm smoking and drinking with friends. So I think that that helps me.
And that game is over with.
And that game is over.
We can put it behind us. Excuse me while I stick the cigar in my eye to burn, though. Sorry.
Yeah, it was bad. Mark Jr. is here in the studio.
Thanks for having me.
How did your team do this week?
We won. We are now 1-1, just like the Patriots.
Okay, F you. Ben, how you doing?
Doing well. Thanks for having me.
Excellent. Glad everyone's here. Ben, thank you for bringing the pumpkin beer. Pumking.
Pumpkin.
Every time I say pumpkin beer, someone corrects me and says, no, Paul, it's Pumking.
I was wondering what the heck you were talking about before the show when I asked you what you were drinking. I'm like, yeah, it's pumpkin beer, but which one?
Pumping beer.
Pumping. Okay.
Who is it? Now, where's it from?
Southern Tier.
And where are they based out of? Are they
question.
California? Are they New Hampshire? Or
New York.
Mm. It's very good. It's got a lot of depth of flavor, as we were commenting before the show.
I think it's my favorite pumpkin beer.
Yeah. It tastes like pumpkin pie, almost.
Mm.
Really?
Mm. Yeah.
And Mr. Santa is MIA tonight, from my understanding?
He is MIA, which means we get to make fun of him the entire show.
Awesome.
Yes. Let's see. So, Tim, you chose the Quesada Jalapa Belicoso, the stogie of the week, for all of us to smoke. And we're all about maybe just getting into past the first third here. So why don't you give us a little background about the stick, and we'll dig right into it and talk about how it's pairing with what you're drinking and how it's going with our Pumking beer here in episode 29.
So, this recently released, based off the Selección España, which was released last year in Spain and very limited in the U.S. We've talked about it a great deal in the past. All of us, I think, are big fans of that release.
I now have a box and then some of the short Belicoso Quesada España.
Am I allowed to say you suck, Paul?
Yeah, the local B&M this weekend had them out on the counter.
Really?
And
interesting.
They were from the original release last year, and I bought all of them.
Somebody's been holding out on me.
I have a full box of the Coronas, too.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, I think everyone had their favorite size. Now, these sizes are very different, Tim, so go ahead.
Yes, they are. So they come in three sizes. We have the Robusto, which is a 4 7/8 by 50. The Belicoso, which we're smoking this evening, which is a 6 1/8 by 52. And the Promenante, which is a 7 5/8 by 49. I would call that a Churchill if I was going to call it something.
Yeah, I said, what is that Churchill size when I saw it?
Yeah.
Pretty much. The only difference from what I understand blend-wise from the España is this sports a Nicaraguan Jalapa wrapper. It retails for about $8.50 a stick, depending on the size. Comes in boxes of 10, and I believe there's only 1,000 boxes of each size released, so it is limited. And I'll tell you what, they've been flying off the shelves from what I can see online. So,
yeah, I really like this blend. Ben and I were commenting before the show, and I think we had some good comments on the flavors that we get from it.
Oh, yeah.
It's definitely got a creaminess, breadiness component to it.
Breadiness, I would agree with that, yeah.
Yeah. Almost nuttiness as well.
It's a lighter cigar, so you do get those cedar notes.
Yeah, yeah. I find the flavors to be kind of subtle, although some will be more prominent depending where you are in the cigar.
Yeah,
I agree. Talking as definitively as I am about these flavors means that I think it's a really great cigar.
Right.
I think it's one everyone should try.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, I have not, this is only my second one that I've smoked of this, and of this size as well. This seems to be everyone's favorite size so far, although I don't know if anyone's taken on the Churchill yet.
No,
not yet. Nope. I smoked a couple of the Robustos earlier in the week, and I can say honestly I'm liking the belly better. Now, did you guys – I want to talk about the pre-light aroma off the wrapper of the cigar. Did you guys take a minute to smell the cigar before you lit it?
Yeah, I did on the first one, and I got kind of a weird almost menthol-y, minty, almost kind of strange flavor off the pre-lit aroma. Yeah.
I called it green tea myself.
Yeah,
I would say I can see that definitely.
It's definitely herbal. Yep, I think you're spot on there, Tim.
But it took me quite a while. I must have sniffed the thing for about 2 minutes straight before I could place it. But very unique. Definitely get some tea flavors off the base. But again, just like Ben said, I get some cedar coming and going, some mild spice. Yeah. It's interesting, though. All these flavors, they don't seem to stay long. They kind of pop in and out for me.
Right.
Which makes it a very interesting cigar to smoke.
Notes. Yeah, yeah. The notes, you think you're right. It's kind of...
And it's mild.
See, I get notes of black pepper, and then I can't place as another note. It's either, it's like a citrusy, but not quite citrusy kind of note that you get every once in a while, but I can't really place it.
I'd agree with that, yep.
Yeah, there's a very little spice and
hint.
I don't get any pepper. I just get a very, very, maybe a tiny bit of spice. Which now, for me, I mean, that makes it a good breakfast cigar for me. I don't like a lot of spice and pepper in my breakfast cigars at all. So this is a great flavor profile for your morning coffee cigar.
I can honestly say the second Robusto I smoked with coffee in the morning, and I enjoyed it much more than I did the one I had smoking in the evening the night before. Yeah.
Now, having said that, here we are sitting around at night drinking beer. And it's holding up pretty well, I think.
I think, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I think you really have to kind of pay attention to the flavors, though.
Mm.
Yeah.
It's
with
one
the
of those,
beer, yeah, definitely.
Yeah, yeah. But it is pairing well. I'm actually quite surprised. Now, Tim, you were pairing it with some Canadian whiskey. Is that right?
I am, actually. And you know what? It's interesting. It's actually holding up, which is amazing. Because, Paul, you and I went back early in the week. Actually, all of us did an email what we were going to pair with this cigar. My thought was it was so mild that I wanted to pair it with something light. But
like an apple teeny?
Actually, a twisted tea. I have it right here in front of me.
Same thing.
I started sending recipes around for Swedish fish martinis earlier in the week just to torment Mark Jr. But
I left my express card at home.
There was definitely some ball busting going on in the emails.
Yeah, yeah.
It was great.
Tim was suggesting
amongst us.
Well, I mean, in all fairness, anything that's not probably beer. Rum and not usually spiced rum, whiskey, scotch is usually not consumed. In fact, it's strictly forbidden here in the workshop. But
you know what, man? I almost drove down there tonight just so I could take out a twisted tea from my briefcase and hand it to Mark Jr. I just wanted to, nail that nail in the coffin. You know, just kind of.
Now, this cigar is the Jalapa, Quesada Jalapa, is very different from the Quesada España.
Oh, absolutely.
I think
so.
I think the flavor they're two totally different cigars.
Oh, yeah.
The España's got a lot more punch to it, I think.
Yeah, considerably more.
Yeah.
And supposedly only the wrapper changed, correct? I mean,
So I've read.
Yeah, that's what I've read.
That's what they say, yeah.
Well, let's go over the blend, actually. The wrapper is Nicaraguan Jalapa. Binder Dominican, and the filler is Broadleaf Connecticut, Dominican, and Nicaraguan. Again, supposedly the Jalapa wrapper is the only thing that changed from the Espana.
Which I think was an Ecuadorian wrapper, wasn't it?
I think you're,
is it?
Yeah. On the Espana, yeah, I believe it's Ecuadorian.
Okay, all right.
Somewhere
in our store. As a mild to medium at best, as far as strength and flavor.
How's everybody's draws on it?
My draw's been good. On both ones that I've smoked, my draw's been excellent.
I've had some tight, not like to the point where you would stop smoking it, but I think the draw on the Quesada is a little tighter than what I would want it to be.
Really?
Yeah, that's just me, though. I mean,
mine's absolutely perfect right now, believe it or not.
Yeah, I like a looser draw, but...
This is the third I've smoked, and the draws have all been perfect for me, so...
Okay.
But that's me personally.
Hmm.
Anyways, on to what we've been smoking, Paul.
Yeah, thank you, Tim. Sorry, I had a mouthful of smoke that I was enjoying the flavors of. So we'll start out kind of on the opposite end of the spectrum of what we're smoking tonight with an Opus X Lost City Toro. These retail for around $30 a stick. This was a great smoke, awesome flavors. it didn't really change up for me a whole lot. I mean, it delivered this kind of like nice, subtle, sweet flavor pretty much throughout the whole thing. Wasn't over the top with, you know, the strength and spice like you would in a typical Opus X. So I think although it has Opus X in it, of course, the Lost City is from a slightly different farm where they filmed the movie and all that stuff that we've talked about on the show in the past. I don't know if it's really worth the price. Like I said, the Toro size was good. But, you know, being $30, the reason I went with the larger size is because there was only like 50 or 60 cents difference right. in price between, you know, yet. So I'm like, well, I might as well get the larger one, but the flavor seemed to kind of be muted a little more in the larger sizes. So I definitely prefer the Robusto. And if you can find the Lancero, Opus X Lost City Lancero is like a magical experience. Cause I think all those flavors really get concentrated in that smaller ring gauge. So
you get more of the wrapper.
Yeah. And I think the wrapper is really what's special on this.
Yeah. I would agree with you that it's probably not worth the cost if you were going to like compare it directly to an Opus X original, right?
Yeah.
But in my opinion, I've had quite a few of them. I've never had that size. And I've really, really enjoyed all them. So even though I might not smoke it as often as I do a regular Opus, I like to have them around.
Yeah.
That,
you know, I rated time, this one, you know? And it's a good point. I rated this one the fiver, and I think that's really in this size, you know, maybe you keep five around. Some of the other sizes you might want to have more. I mean, the price tag is a little daunting, but they really do hold up.
What would be the tipping price for you, like if you saw it at a certain price, you'd be like, oh yeah, that's,
oh yeah, I mean it, like at half that price, at $15 a stick, which is still pretty expensive for one cigar, let's not kid ourselves. I mean, it's box worthy all day long.
I bought a bunch at 20 off a cigar bid earlier.
Yeah, at 20
year.
I would buy a bunch, absolutely.
I bought a bunch of Lanceros and a bunch of Robusto.
Yeah, Lanceros, I mean, I would pay 25. I would probably buy a box of Lanceros at $20 a stick. I really liked that cigar a lot.
My thought is actually, if it was solely based on flavor, I would say it was box worthy.
Mm.
If it, but you bring price into it, and then that knocks it down.
Yeah, definitely. I agree. Tim, over it's to you.
Okay. Speaking of pricey, I smoked the Viaje 5th Anniversary this week. 6.25x52 Perfecto. It had an absolute beautiful wrapper on it. It reminded me a lot of the wrapper on the Viaje Friends and Family, which was released earlier in this year. It started out smooth, some oak, mild pepper, occasional leather, never really passed medium in strength. The leather didn't remain long. But on the second half, I had some problems. It started to go out a little bit. I had to relight several times. And then the flavors just went south and turned sour and bitter. So I think I chucked it towards the last third, which was disappointing, considering I believe this was $12 a whack for these sticks.
So this is the 5th anniversary, Tim?
Correct. Yeah. You talked about it on the last show.
Okay, I gotcha.
Now, you like this, Paul, right?
Yeah, I thought this was really good.
Yeah, I think maybe I just got a bad stick. I don't know, maybe it was young, maybe it was wet, maybe it was just construction problems. But I did enjoy it up until the second half.
I think I said it on the last show, too. The finish wasn't its most shining achievement of this cigar.
Yeah, and I was curious. Did you mean the finish as in the finish of the cigar or the finish on your palate? Out of
Yeah, the last third of the cigar. Okay. As in the way the flavors that were presented in the final third were not as good as the ones in the first two thirds. So
I believe
it didn't wow me, but it was good enough that I would say try one if you come across them.
Mm.
I don't think it's, you know, the best offering Viaje is coming up with, but I think it's worth a look. So.
You know, I'm almost toying with, we need to come up with a new rating.
Okay.
We need to come up with a, it was good, but
a revisited?
There was one part of it that was kind of off, and therefore, give it a year of age, and Stogie Santa will like go in the back and like bring out a box and like smoke one, and then if it's really good, be like, guys, guess what I have, and then we'll all like be fighting over to like split up, to split up the rest of the box. So I don't know what we'd call that, because that was a really long name to call a rating, but
let's put some thought to that. Yeah,
I wish they aged
this more. That very well may be the case in this. I think it might be just a little young.
It's like, you know, in a year it could be fabulous.
Yep.
Kind of thing.
Fabulous.
We'll call it the investment.
Or an incomplete.
The investment.
Yeah. It's an incomplete.
Yeah. Alrighty. I smoked a Quaba Salamon. This was a trade that I got with someone who I believe just popped into the chat room. Zedman, yeah, I'm going to be talking about all the sticks that we traded for. I just have one sentence for this smoke. Smoke of the week, baby. This nice. Thing just poured flavor, poured smoke. The construction was a little loose, but I would rather have that than have it be plugged. So... It smoked great. There was a slight crack. I think, you know, it came a long distance to get to me. So I think some of it might have resulted in shipping, as you can see in the picture. It really didn't affect the smoking. I mean, I smoked right through that little tear in the wrapper, and it was totally fine.
Now, you said the construction was loose. Did it hold an ash out of curiosity?
It did, yeah. It did, yeah. It was just, the draw was really loose on it, which, I mean, for a Salamone, my guess is they probably roll them that way deliberately so that you don't get a tight draw. Because, I mean, right off the bat, I mean, you guys know, like, when you smoke the Salamone size, sometimes that first part is really tough. This one was, like, right off the bat. And it just immediately started pouring cedar flavor, hints of earth. I mean, it was just a wonderful, very, very prominent Cuban flavors. Like, very pronounced on your palate, Cuban flavors. You know, the finish wasn't too great, though. You know, the final third was kind of just okay, but man, I want more of these because they're really awesome.
I enjoy the line. I've never had that size, but
oh really,
the stuff that I've had from that line has always been very good.
Mm-hmm.
They may all be Figurados, actually.
I think you're right.
I think now that I think
there's
back,
Generosos is a smaller, looks like a small Salamone.
Yep. And then I had one that's almost like a short story size too.
Yes.
And now that I'm thinking about it, I think they were all, preferidos or...
No, do you remember them? But. Do you remember them smoking that way? Like, really easy draw? Clouds of smoke. I mean, huge clouds of smoke.
The reason I asked about the ash is because if the cigar is underfilled...
Yeah, your ash will...
Usually will not hold an ash. Yeah. So, I think you're right. If it was holding an ash, it was rolled that way purposely, probably. But... That's just my opinion. What do I know?
Yeah, this is, again, my smoke of the week. And I did a lot of smoking of various Cuban cigars this week. And this was my favorite.
Cool.
I think. Although, nice. I don't know, there's another one up that's up there, too. But
nice.
This one,
we'll get there.
Because of the experience of it all, this was my favorite.
Very cool.
Over to you, Tim.
So I did the Kahuno 2012 Habano, finally. Which is the Ecuadorian Habano version of the 2012 Kahuno from Pete Johnson.
Mm-hmm.
It has a Nicaraguan binder and filler. It opened up with some, excuse me, with some pepper and a lot of rich flavors, coffee, chocolate. The pepper was especially strong through the retrohale, I thought. Stick was full flavored and bodied, beautiful draw and burn, beautiful stick, absolutely gorgeous wrapper. Really nice presentation. I think I like this one more than I like the Sumatra Broadleaf, which was also released this year. I would say five are possibly box worthy if you're looking to age a few. But again, like we talked about last week, the Kahuno 2003 really holds my heart as far as this line is concerned.
I still think it's the belle of the ball.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. I'll tell you what, though, I have to say this is probably second place for me. I really did enjoy the stick. And I think with some age, it's going to be phenomenal. The Sumatra really did not impress me this year. And, you know, the Broadleaf was good, but I like the Habano.
Now, coincidentally, that's the one that did not come in the book thing.
Right.
Which I bought a book thing.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. I don't know.
You know what?
We may need to put the book thing up in the forum. Although, I don't think it's a complete book thing. I think I may have smoked out of it already.
Need to revisit after a year just to see what they're doing with age.
When did the book thing come out? I'm calling it the book thing. I'm sure there's a better name for it.
I believe it was March.
Yeah.
Marchish.
Sounds about that. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, maybe I'll give it a year and see what happens. I smoked an EP Carrillo New Wave Connecticut Short Run 2012 Invictos. This is the larger size. This is a 5.8 by 52. I had just okay flavors, kind of muted in this size, because I know the flavors that should come from this line. I much prefer the Esquisitos, the 4.8 by 50. All day long, the flavors are much more pronounced. This one, it was kind of muted. I had it with coffee kind of in the morning, and I wasn't really blown away. Now, I had the Esquisitos in the morning with coffee, and it blew me away. So, I mean, it goes to show, I mean, EPC can have some real winners, and sometimes even stuff in the same line will, the size will just make all the difference in the world. And I hate to say that about EPC, because I met him in person. He's such a super nice guy. And again, some of his sticks are just like out of this world, but some magical. Of them just, I mean, some, they're not all winners, you know?
Yep.
And I guess, I don't know, name a cigar manufacturer that has all winners.
No one hits a home run every time.
They all can't exactly. be winners.
That's right. That's right.
Out of curiosity, any of you smoke the inch yet?
I have not.
I have.
Ben did.
Yeah, okay. it wasn't my favorite. No, but it's one of his more moderately priced cigars, so... maybe I didn't take that into effect. It didn't. I don't think it burned as well as the regular line does.
Okay. As a side note, though, if you look at some of the things that are selling well and popular, you ask the cigar manufacturers, right? Rocky Patel recently, I heard an interview with him. He said the one of the unbanded that you got, Tim, was his like number one selling cigar. It's the Edge. Like, it's not the one I gave you. It's actually the 60 ring Edge. Battalion.
Okay. Battalion, yes.
The Edge Battalion, number one selling stick. So, while, you know, everyone's sitting here on the show, we're not a big fan of that 60 ring. Clearly, there's a ton of cigar smokers out there that right. love that 60 ring size. And I bet you, for people who like that 60 ring size, they're going to probably like EPC's offering on that. If you thought it was good and didn't...
Well, it was decent. It's just, that, like I said, the construction... I only smoked one, but the construction wasn't that good.
Yeah.
That's a 64 ring gauge or 65? Is up there.
There's two sizes, I believe. There's
60 and a 64.
Thank you. Yeah, and I had smoked the smaller of the two. But yeah, I thought the flavors were decent. It's just it wasn't remarkable.
Yeah, yeah.
I've heard other people say that his 60 rings are the best. Like of people that like that size, that his 60 rings are the best.
He usually does make a good
short run. His short runs actually.
The short run in his core line 60 ring, people say they really like. I wasn't a big fan of it.
The cigar he made before he left La Gloria Cubana, in that special humidor, the La Gloria Cubana Series R, that was.
Yes.
That one's phenomenal.
That was probably up there as one of my favorite 60 rings I smoked.
It's like a 2.5 hour, 3 hour smoke, but it's awesome.
That's a journey is what that is. Yeah.
Back to you, Tim.
So, something unique I smoked this week, actually a gift from Big Al, thank you, Al, was the Emilio Drake Robusto. This is a limited edition run. It's a 5x50 Robusto. It features a Honduran and Nicaraguan fillers with a Colombian Maduro wrapper. The blend, limited release in 2012. I already said that. It's also available in a 5.5x42 Corona and a 6x60.
What's on the band? I'm sorry.
Tim, just so you know, a little side production note. Those of you watching the live stream can see a little bit of it, but we do have the show notes portion where we the Stogie's feed. Nice. Yeah, up on the big screen here in the studio. So
it's a dragon.
Pink dragon.
It's a pink dragon, correct. Now I have my doubts with the smoke because the brand as a whole, Gary Griffith seems like a nice guy, a really nice guy, but either his smokes just don't fit my flavor profile, or in the case of the Grimalkin, which I liked, I've had major construction issues in the 5 or 6 times I smoked that cigar. So I had my doubts when I picked this up, but I got to tell you what, man, it was a good, solid smoke. I got lots of rich flavors of leather, dark chocolate, a lot of berries on the finish.
Now Big Pete is kind of confirming, because Mark Jr. and I looked at it when we said pink dragon, like that just sounds dirty. Like, he says, "Oh, I thought that was." He goes, "I thought that was porn." I'm like, "That does. It sounds dirty. Like, I don't know if I want to put a pink dragon in my mouth or not. I don't know."
Dragon.com is registered. Hold on, I'll be back in a few minutes.
Yeah.
But yeah, the draw was perfect. The cigar produced fantastic amount of smoke. Great flavors. Well balanced. I did have to relight once or twice on the second half. but it never took away from the experience. And I certainly recommend it as at least a fiver. I only smoked one, so I can't do any better than that, but I'm going to be revisiting.
How was the burn again?
It was good. I had a relight twice on the second half. Draw was great. I don't know if it was construction with the relight or if just the Colombian wrapper. I can't say I've ever smoked a cigar with a Colombian wrapper before, to be quite honest with you. But I will say that that wrapper offered up some really unique flavors. I think it's worth a try. I may actually get a fiver just so we can smoke them on the show, because I think it's a unique smoke. You guys would probably enjoy it. So
did you lick the pink dragon before you cut it so that it wouldn't fall apart? Is that...
Well, actually, I got the wrapper I got the band in my wallet. I carried around with me.
There you go.
You tasted the berries, though. You tasted the berries.
Nice.
So I think I can top your construction problems. I had a Bolivar gold medal. Now everyone,
okay, go ahead.
Everyone said these were awesome.
I think they are.
Well, they might be, but I mean the construction on this one sucked. Like, so bad. And I tried so hard to smoke it because it was the only one I had, and it came from a trade, and I'm like, I'm going to fight through it. And, like, it was weird. The first couple of thirds, two-thirds maybe, had, like, a void in it. So, like, it wouldn't smoke. But the last third seemed to be plugged. Like, whoever rolled it was smoking crack or something. So I'd like, you know, I'd poke it and then there'd be this huge void, and then I'd try and like burn my way around the void or pack the void down, and then there'd just be another void. So then I'd clipped it because I'm like, it's not doing anything, and I clip it and then I try and smoke it again, and there'd be another void, and then the hole would that I used to poke it to open it up would close. It was just a nightmare. After like 10 minutes, I was like, I can't do it anymore. Like, I was just more frustrated with it than anything else.
You see, everybody says these are great, but I've heard the same things from other people as far as the construction is concerned, dude.
Yeah, it's just a complete train wreck.
Yeah. Which is amazing to me, because we smoked the belly and the Petite Corona on the show.
Never had a problem with the belly or
Petite
Corona.
Great cigars. Yeah, both flavor and construction.
Yeah.
I smoked two in my life, and I didn't have a problem with either one of them.
Interesting,
But that's only two, you know.
Yeah,
that could be the,
I just
luck of the draw on the other side, you know.
Yeah. So back to you, Tim.
So I finally smoked the Ratzilla from Lico Privada. A lot of you guys told me that it was young, not good. So I put it down for 6 weeks, which was killing me because I only had one. But I finally lit it up this week. It is a 6.25x46 Corona Gorda, blended with Nicaraguan and Honduran fillers, a Brazilian Matafita binder, and Connecticut Valley stock cut cured sun-grown Habano wrapper.
Wow.
That's a mouthful.
No kidding.
Full-bodied, full flavor, poured smoke like most Ligas do. I had no construction issues. Flavor-wise, I got a lot of coffee, leather, cedar, and lots of pepper, especially on the retrohale. I enjoyed it. Is it better than the Dirty Rat? No, the Dirty Rat's still my favorite. But I would say box worthy with the caveat of the price. I mean, $15 a stick, really, is kind of pricey, even if you can find them. I don't know if it was the rest that did it some good, or if just my opinion differs from you guys.
Would you stick with the Dirty Rat over this?
Oh, hell yeah. Every day. Yeah. I mean, the Dirty Rat, I think, is my favorite offering from the brand.
Yeah, definitely.
especially if you can put 5 to 6 months on those things. Wow. I mean, just four to six months, really. They just become something special at that point. But I think if you come across them, it's worth a visit. I want to say there was only maybe 85 bundles of these things that went out. Back in the spring, so we were all lucky enough to get one or two ourselves. Either way, one of the highlights of my week. I enjoyed it a great deal. Nubbed it, no problem.
Okay.
So
interesting. I'm kind of the oddball. I prefer the L40 out of all those special releases that come out.
You really like that smoke.
Yeah.
I like the L40, but to me, the Dirty Rat's the...
Yeah, I just, I don't... I don't know.
It's dirty.
Yeah, I think Mocking Junior. The Dirty Rat is dirty. We
you
like
guys,
it.
You guys love the Dirty Rats.
Yeah.
I smoked an EP Carrillo Dark Ritual just as kind of like a redo, kind of see how they're doing kind of thing.
Episode number two smoke, I believe, right?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, they're still smoking awesome. I think they even smoothed out more over time, and smoke them if you got them. I mean, go back and smoke one or two if you bought a box, because they're really good. And like I said, they smoothed out, and some of the so I think some of the more subtle flavors can come out now that you know, you get that smoothness from the age.
Okay, so. That was a really, really awesome smoke from last year.
Yeah, yes,
I'm looking forward to their limited 2012 offering.
That should be coming around soon, actually.
Yeah.
Tim, back to you.
That was so one of the ones. Well, how's everybody Jalapa doing?
Yeah, actually? That's a good. It's a good time because, I mean, you've got the Jalapa Robusto on your list.
I do.
And I get that herbal tea flavor that you're talking about. It's like a very subtle herbal kind of tea.
Yeah, I don't get that, but
it dissipates quickly, but
it's a note.
It's a note, yeah. There's definitely a.
Yeah, I don't know if I really picked up on that either, but I did have what I would describe as a buttery taste.
Yes, I get that.
Like about halfway through the cigar. It's gone now, but it
they
was...
They took that cream and
yeah, but it,
it
was like
butter.
A really, really...
No, it's buttery.
...enjoyable flavor that I got there for a little while, and I'm kind of excited about it. I don't know if I've ever gotten that flavor, like that flavor that's reminded me of that before.
Yeah. So. I missed a lot of, I think, the subtle flavors the first time around with this stick, because I had smoked in España before this one, and I should have done them the other way around.
Vice versa, yeah.
I said that to you in chat the other day. I was like, put the España out light up first.
And today I'm smoking it with a completely fresh palate for today. It's my first cigar of the day, so I think I think that really helped me out in picking out some of the flavors. I'm not one to usually get tea from a flavor from the cigar, but it definitely was recognizable for a couple of puffs, and then it was gone. And if someone hadn't told me to look for that, I probably wouldn't have found it.
So. Right.
So what's interesting about the smoke is we're all getting different stuff off of it, because I get the tea as the base. Consistently throughout the smoke, I get tea with a lot of other things coming and going. Now, the end of the first third, I got a lot of pepper on the retrohale, but again... It was gone in a matter of 90 seconds. I mean, it was there for a few draws, and then, boom, gone. Now I'm starting the second, third, and, you know, I'm back to that tea-based flavoring, which I'm enjoying.
I get hints of pumpkin pie, but that's probably because I'm drinking the pumpkin beer. And I tell you what, the flavors are very complimentary.
Oh, yeah.
I think, yeah. Surprisingly enough.
Yeah, I the caramel and the buttery.
Ben
the
brought the pumpkin beer, and I'm like, oh, it's fall. I had pumpkin coffee this morning. It was awesome.
I love pumpkin everything this time of year.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
Exactly. It's very exciting time here
pumpkin
in New England.
Pumpkin pancakes.
Yeah,
pumpkin
everything.
Have you ever had pumpkin raviolis?
No.
Yes.
But I want some now.
Dude, they're awesome. They're awesome.
They are. They are.
Yeah, the pumpkin coffee I had, I mean, just the pumpkin coffee was actual real pumpkin coffee. It wasn't like they took a glob of pumpkin-flavored sugar and, like, threw it in my coffee after. It was actual pumpkin coffee.
The pumpkin raviolis.
Where'd you get it?
Brewed Awakenings on Pontiac Avenue.
Okay, that's nice.
It's brand new. It's not that far from yeah.
I'm going to have to go check that out.
You have to check that out. It's brand new. It's really good.
Support the local business,
They've
man.
Got the coffee on like a beer tap.
No kidding.
They look like beer taps, but it's coffee.
Cool.
Yeah.
I'm definitely going to go check that out.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
Cool.
So, if you're in the area, check that out with your morning cigar.
Too. Great name.
Yeah. So, Tim, the Jalapa Robusto, I mean, we kind of already talked about it. I like your pictures for those of you that
they're
want to visit.
Pretty, aren't they?
Yeah, stogiegeeks.com/stogies. You can check it out. They're very
now,
nice.
Let me say one thing about this box, actually, because it's something that Machi
did you buy the box, or did you just borrow someone else's for the photos?
No, I bought a box of Robustos.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, a Big Al and I split them, actually.
Nice.
I bought a box of each.
Let me say this, though, because Mock Jr. commented on some construction shipping issues last week, damage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was what I heard, yeah.
One thing I noticed about this box is these things were packed in there tight.
I know.
Tight, because I took the plastic wrappers off of these for the pitcher, and I had trouble getting them back in. I actually damaged the foot of one. And I think that might be where some of the shipping issues may be coming from.
You would think that would actually cut down on it, yeah, actually.
Because they won't slide. I was thinking the same thing, because they won't knock around. Like, yeah. Sometimes inside of a coffin or a tube, you know, they've got room to knock around in there, and that will actually cause the wrapper to crack.
They were jammed in there pretty good, man, I got to say.
And they had cellophane on them, too.
Yes, they were. Whatever, I'm bringing it up as a conversation piece. I've never seen a cigar jammed into a box like that before. Beautiful box, beautiful. But there were four or five nicks on the outside of the box when I took the plastic off the box. So it's obvious that, you know.
Someone was throwing it around.
Somebody, I don't know if maybe a pallet or something fell off the back of the truck somewhere and nobody said anything, you know?
Yeah.
I don't blame Quesada. I don't think it's them at all. It's probably something that happened in shipping. Right. But I sourced these from a different, completely different source than Mark Jr. did. So,
well, I got one box from one source and another box from another source, and I had no problems with either one of them. So
maybe
it was just, you know, it is what it is, I guess. But
whatever. They're smoking great. So I got no complaints. I can deal with a little foot damage.
Yeah. Yeah.
Only a one or two sticks, and it could be from me prying the damn things out of the box of all I know, you know. Great smoke, great presentation. Moving on.
I think the band is beautiful as well too.
Oh yeah,
I think beautiful. It's very, yeah, it's both like it's kind of elegant and simplistic at the same time. But
and I actually brought the box up to a coworker of mine because he takes cigar boxes and make guitars and guitar tuners out of them. And he was pretty jacked because he thought it was going to make a great guitar tuner. It's a really beautiful box. So.
Yeah, so my next one here is, I was so excited to smoke this. I mean, I was giddy with excitement. And I have two of these to
like
smoke. Yeah, so I had to light one up recently. This is the Cohiba Bahique. This is the one of the larger size Cohiba Bahiques. I showed them to. Now, I didn't get this from our normal like vetted sources. It wasn't traded with someone who I know is getting them from a reputable source. This just happened to be a friend that I saw when I was at a conference traveling and handed me a couple of these, and I showed them to Stogie Santa because I was kind of questioning it, and he was like, "Well, he's like, the bands look real. He's like, the wrapper color looks real." He said the foot, or the head rather, with the little pigtail, it's like, that looks real. And everything about the stick looked authentic until I lit it up. It had a nice flavor. It was enjoyable. I mean, not much changes, but it was not a genuine Cohiba Bahique. I mean, I even did the faux power of letting Stogie Santa take a draw because he has smoked a real one before. And he's like, no. He's like, it's actually pretty good for a fake Cuban. He's like, it's pretty damn good. I mean, I enjoyed it. It wasn't Cuban tobacco.
Not a $50 Bahique, though.
No, certainly. Yeah. Certainly not.
Bummer.
Now, I did take a look at your picture and the band, and I compared it.
Yeah.
And, that band was well done. If that was a fake.
Yeah. That's what Stogie Santa was saying. Weird. You can kind of see, and I'll take some better pictures of the other one that I have in my humidor. But the band is pretty authentic. In fact, it may be the real band from a Bahique that they've just slapped on a different
Did you cigar. It was hard to tell from the picture, but did you compare the hologram in the band to the
I gave my band to Stogie Santa to compare with the real one, so hopefully he'll have a picture for us for the website soon to see if there's any differences and if the hologram matched up. So.
Yeah, there was a lot of reflection off the light in the picture, so I couldn't tell, but it did look pretty authentic from what I could tell.
Yeah, I mean, I won't rate it. I mean, I'm disappointed, a little upset, but on the flip side, I did enjoy the cigar, and it wasn't horrible. It was actually pretty good. Whatever they did to use to fake it wasn't that bad, and I think they probably did that to fool people to say, well, this is a pretty good, you know.
No banana leaves in there.
Yeah, they didn't put crap in it. So I can't wait to try the real thing now. I mean, that really just fueled my fire to go get the real thing now and see what it's like. That's really all it did. The fact that it was free, too. I mean, if I had paid $50 for it, I'd be super pissed. Mm-hmm. And I know the person giving it to me didn't pay $50 for it either. So
we should.
The real thing is doable if you're willing to pay a price. That's,
We should get together, like, try and find enough people so we split a box, like, and each get one or something like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
There is a sampler of three, I believe, for $130, at least the last time I looked. But
yeah, you can find samplers.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah. I'll give you the website after the show.
Cool.
Over to you, Tim.
So I smoked the Casa Magna Colorado Short Robusto that Stogie Santa sent me up. Also from the same people that bring us Quesada, SAG Imports. This Nicaraguan Puro had absolutely gorgeous dark oily wrapper. Stick poured lots of aromatic smoke. They remind me of a lot of the smell of hickory, if I could compare it to anything. I'm not real good with picking out different types of wood, but if I had to pick one, I would say hickory on this one. Full bodies and smooth, nice mix of wood, spiced coffee, and raisins. It was what I got off the finish, a kind of raisin sweetness. Creamy, and the spice became more dominant on the second, third. I did have one instance where the cigar completely canoed on me, but a quick relight, and it was right back on par. I enjoyed it immensely. I'd say a fiver, especially for those weekend evenings where, you know, I've had a large meal and I'm looking for something with that medium full side of the flavor profile. Great smoke. Check it out. So
I enjoyed mine as well. I picked one up when I was at the store the other day, and the new box press ones are pretty good.
Yeah, I have to. Yeah, that's one good point, actually. This was a box press, which is new.
It's much better than the originals, I think.
I think so, too. So, great smoke.
Excellent. Yeah, I've always thought the original, a lot of the Casa Magna Colorado stuff, right? That's some of the one, the Cigar of the Year and all that
yep.
stuff.
Yeah,
I always thought they were, like, good, but, like, nothing to really, like, write home about.
Certainly not best cigar. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think the pricing point really pushed that because it was only like $5.50
at the time. Yeah.
Yeah. I smoke them when I go to the beach and stuff. After my frustration of smoking a faux Cuban cigar, I lit up a Cohiba Genios. This is Cohiba's Maduro line. They come, I think, in a few different sizes, maybe even three different sizes. I've had the Magicos before. That's the short Robusto. The Genius is more traditional Robusto, 5.5x52. Again, it's a Maduro wrapper. And this one was authentic Cuban cigar. I definitely got those that hint of Cuban flavor that, you know, I call it like a cedary, earthy type flavor that's very easily picked out if you've smoked, I think, a lot of Cuban cigars. This one was extremely smooth and poured this wonderful, like on top of those traditional Cuban flavors, poured this coffee flavor. I mean, just begged me to drink it with a nice black cup of coffee. I'd buy more. I'm not sure that they're worth the price. You know, maybe with some age, they would be bordering on Oasis is kind of the way I put it. I think as they are now, they're box worthy because, I mean, they go well with one of my favorite beverages to have with a cigar, and that's a nice dark black cup of coffee. So
I thought it was very interesting. I smoked this exact one as well. Very interesting to taste a Cuban cigar with a Maduro wrapper because that's not very common.
It's not. Yeah.
As a matter of fact, I don't know of any other ones.
I don't know of any other ones either.
But yeah, no, it was a very, very unique and enjoyable experience, and I would agree with your rating on that. Even though they're expensive, I would still would like to eventually get a box of them.
Yeah. Now, I don't know if I could really tell you either way which one I liked better, the Magicos or the Genios yet. I don't know. I'd have to smoke more of each to really kind of pick my... I haven't smoked a Magico in a long time, so...
I think the Magico is more popular, though. I think.
Yes. The Magico is, like, their most popular, I think, Maduro. Mm.
Yep.
No, but this was great. This is another gift from a different friend, so... I gave him back an Añejo Shark.
And then it's good to have friends.
It's a fair trade.
It's a pretty fair trade, right?
I think so.
So, back to you, Tim.
So, you're waiting to... are you ready to talk about this Oliva that we both smoked last night?
Yeah, let's do it. You know, I don't think I took a picture of it, so go for it.
I thought you had one up there, but
Maybe I did.
Yeah. So this is the Oliva Serie V. How do you pronounce this?
Milano.
Reserva Limitata, and this is the torpedo size. So Paul sent us all a text last night. Anybody else smoking? And sent us a picture of this, and I had just finished the exact same cigar and the exact same vitola. Yeah, exactly, right? So this is a 6.5x52 torpedo from Oliva, just released at IPCPR this year. It sports the Ecuadorian Sumatra wrapper, from what I've read. It started with rich tobacco, some coffee, some pepper, and some really odd floral notes in the background in the first third. Now, the second third, I still continue to get some of that coffee and rich tobacco, but the finish became very salty and dry for me, which I am just not a fan of that. Some people like it. I do not. I experienced something very similar with the Oliva Serie V Maduro Special from last year, which seemed to kind of dissipate with some age on it, because I recently smoked those again, and I didn't get the same experience, if you will. Now the last third became very enjoyable for me. I got a lot more earthiness, some leather hints, and I nubbed it. Really enjoyed the last third. Construction was awesome. I had a really nice white ash that held for an inch and a half before dropping each time. Overall, I just wasn't a fan of the flavor profile. It seemed kind of all over the place, if you will. The transitions weren't smooth.
I didn't find a whole lot of balance in the cigar.
Yeah, the transitions were not smooth. I think maybe some age would help it. I question if the size choice I chose was wrong, but something about the Oliva line, I'm always kind of drawn towards that torpedo for some reason, maybe because of the Maduro Specials. They usually were traditionally in that vitola, and I love those. I absolutely love those.
Yeah. They make a great torpedo.
Yeah. So when I saw them, it's immediately what I was drawn to. It was the torpedo. I say try one.
That was my rating, too. I had great construction and burn on this stick, but there was this kind of bitterness, and it kind of hinted towards a youngness in this cigar. Now, there was some sweetness that kind of came and went throughout, but it wasn't as prominent as I would have liked it to have been. The finish was, I described it as weird. I wasn't a big fan. I think I put it down a little ways through the final third. Like I said, try one for now. Aged may be kind to these cigars, and yeah, that bitterness may subside, and those sweet flavors may come to the forefront a little more. But, overall, I wasn't a big fan, and I say try one, see if you like it. Now, I have heard that the Petite Corona,
I was just going to say,
was really, really good in this line.
Yeah.
So and by the time I got into the shop, they were so good. In fact, they were sold out. So
I got two of the Petite Coronas, I got two of the Robustos, and I got two of the Torpedos. Mm-hmm. I smoked one of each of all of them so far. I found the Torpedo to be the least desirable of the three. The Robusto is a little bit better. And as far as the Petite Corona goes, I would call it box-worthy. I thought it was awesome. I thought it was very well balanced. I had a lot of really nice balanced pepper and spice to it, and it was just really, really enjoyable, actually. Yep. So I think it's going to come down to size with this blend, to be honest with you.
I hear what you're saying with the bitterness too, Paul, because the coffee flavors I was getting was more of a bitter coffee, if anything. Did you get any of the saltiness out of curiosity?
I didn't get any saltiness from it.
Okay. I don't think I did either.
There's certainly some Davidoffs that, it's unmistakable saltiness that you get from
it. And I remember what you're talking about, actually, with last year's Limited.
Maduro.
Yeah. Maduro. Yeah. I definitely agree with that assessment.
So I smoked Hoyo de Monterey Epicure number 1, and this was a fantastic smoke. Just those classic Cuban flavors. So a little touch of spice, some cedar, a nice earthy base to it, and just, it poured flavor, and I loved every minute of it. I can't wait to smoke more of these. This is definitely on my list of ones to go out and seek more of, because it was really, really good.
I agree.
It's kind of like a Corona. I think it's a Corona-ish size. I don't have the size.
Yep.
It's definitely, it looks like a Corona in the picture. It was just a great size, great flavor, all around great cigar. I was glad that I tried it.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like one of those staple Cuban type
sizes
in brands that are out there. So
yeah, absolutely.
It's one of the kind of staples, I think, of your Cuban cigar diet. So
very nice.
Back to Tim.
So the next one on my list are all ones I've talked about in the past. It's stuff I listed as stuff I cannot stop smoking. So it's basically stuff we've talked about. I consider box worthy, but I took down several of these during the last week. The first of which is the Elogio Habano Corona Extra. Finally smoked the last of the box of 25 I bought back in May. I actually have a box of Robustos on the way this week, which I'm looking forward to try a different size than these. Absolutely love this smoke with coffee in the morning. It's my go-to weekend smoke with coffee in the morning. Smooth, toasty, toasted marshmallows. Ben Lee from Nice Tight Ash described it as. Absolutely love it. If you get a chance, check it out. A really, really good smoke.
Nice.
One of the others is the LFD Colorado Squirrel. I've probably taken down three or four of these in the last week. Powerful, full-flavored, full-strength, really good. I don't know if it's something about a tough day at work. I get an urge to grab one of these. Really, really good smoke. Love every second of them, both in terms of flavor and power. And they always perform well.
Nice.
I
need to revisit some of the Elogio stuff.
Well, tell you what, man, I'll bring you down one of the Robustos when they come in so you can check out.
Yeah, I'll give it a whirl. Thank you.
Yeah. I really think you will enjoy it with coffee in the morning, man. It's a good, solid smoke. Not the most complex, but just enjoyable. And for $6 a stick.
Yeah.
You got to take price into account, too. It really is an everyday smoke for me, you know. I just wish they were more readily available, but...
Now, along those lines, Tim, let's save your last one here and kind of transition into one of the unbandits that I gave you. Did you have that on your list, or?
Are we talking about the Rocky, or?
Yeah, yeah.
So, yeah, I kind of messed up and accidentally deleted the notes in the picture.
Yeah.
So I'm going to go off memory here.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't like it.
No, we think that was the Maduro. I think it was a Rocky Patel...
Edge,
Maduro, the Toro size. I forget what they call the Toro size.
I believe it was, yeah.
Yeah, and you weren't a big fan.
Yeah, I was working late one night. I kind of had to hang out and wait for my engineers to run some fiber optics for me. So I sat outside to smoke this. Really strong, in your face, and I'm going off of memory here. Espresso, leather, pepper, but none of it was balanced.
Mm-hmm.
It was just up in your face. It raped my palate. It just completely raped my palate. I really did not enjoy that smoke. Can't see why anybody would. I mean, I've had strong smokes. We just talked about the LFD, for example.
Mm-hmm.
But that has a lot of balance. It has a lot of finesse, you know? This was the complete opposite. It was just...
It was a blunt instrument.
Yeah, it was too much of everything. You know,
now,
it was...
Now, what's interesting, in the Rocky Patel Edge line, they put some kind of filler, which they don't tell anyone about.
Like, yeah.
They have some code word for it, but they don't list... They keep it a secret.
Don't worry, nobody wants it, so...
This is a very, very popular line.
Extreme, absolutely.
One of the most popular lines.
Yeah, they sell the crap out of them.
And a lot of that, I think, is the price point. So maybe a little bit in this section or maybe a little bit in the next section. Keep in mind, for $6,
yep.
I mean, all of us know there's better stuff out there. Now, Tim, the reason it sparked my this conversation was you said the Elogio is also $6. Now, a totally different kind of smoke, but yes. It goes to show you what you can get for $6. There's a lot of stuff out there at that price point, especially if you look into the online auctions like we've talked about in the past. There's a ton of stuff you can get for $6 that's light years better, more balanced. Better flavors.
Aren't those short runs that we talked about, the Exquisitos and that $6 range too?
$6.50
or something like that?
I believe they are. Yes, they are. Sir. Yeah, I mean, I gave it a shot, but yeah, I won't be revisiting. Now that you told me what it was, because while I was smoking, I was like, what the hell did Paul give me? Like, it was...
Well, you know, I think with Unbanded, there's two different takes you can have on it, right? There's the, I can give you something that if you saw it, you would never smoke it because of the brand, because it's known to be a budget smoke. It's known to be something that I know you don't like. Or, you know, it's considered to not be the greatest smoke, right? So I'm going to give it to you unbanded, and maybe you'll think it's awesome. And then when I tell you what it is, you're going to be like, oh, my God, I can't believe I thought that that cigar was good. And then I can go the other way. I can give you something more expensive, a little more held in higher regard, right, as a fine premium hand-rolled cigar. Yep. And you can go, wow, that was a dog rocket, you know, and it's something that is very expensive and held in
higher regard. Kind of like what you did to Mark Jr. and I a couple, a few months ago with the Gurkha, right?
Yeah, and you guys really liked the Gurkha. And
it was good. I was going to mention that as a good example of that. Yep. It was... Yeah.
But what I'm finding I need to do, though, is when I give everyone an unbanded, is I need to give a couple of each, or one, at least one of each, right? One of that kind of low, what you would consider lower end, something you would never smoke. Then maybe something that is held in higher regard, and give you both unbanded and let you try both to kind of round it out. That's my strategy going forward with unbanded.
Now, I've never smoked an Edge before, but I have been told that they're not as good as they used to be.
Unfortunately, that's the way it's turned out with quite a few of his blends, because I remember when I first started
the Old World Reserve Maduro
in those short the short torpedo box press ones. I loved them. And then when I finally ran out of the ones that I had, I went back and bought more, and I was like, God, this is definitely not the same thing.
That's one that sticks out in everyone's mind. Every cigar smoker that's had those old and new says the same thing. Like, it's... Everyone can tell. I think a lot of manufacturers change the blends, and some people can tell, some people can't. If they're really good, they do, you know, the crops change out, like we said before, and you can't tell the difference, and that's... Yep. But anyway.
Well, I think that's a nod to the blended, too. If the crops change, they're always going to change from year to year, right? But if the blender can adjust to that...
Right.
Then that's a real nod to their skill level.
Absolutely.
I mean, what do I know? I mean, I'm just kind of, you know, shooting from the hip here. But I would think that would be the case. I mean, if they can adjust to the crops changing every year.
So I smoked an H. Upman Magnum 50. This is kind of one of those other quintessential Cuban size blends, manufacturer kind of things. It was just an okay smoke. The flavors were a lighter cedar earth Cuban-esque flavor profile that went along with it. And it needs to kick it up in the flavor department probably by four or five times to be box-worthy. So I had it as a 2.5 try one. This is another, like, Corona-ish size. Another, I think Big Pete was saying the other one, the Epicurean one's 46 ring.
I remember a little while back I gave you a Magnum 46.
Yeah,
I think it was, and you said the smoke smelled like cat piss or something like that.
So maybe I'm just not a big fan of the H oven. So maybe the 50 is a 50 ring. Is the number denote the ring size? It could.
I don't know off the top of my head, but that could be right.
Yeah. I apologize. I didn't have a lot of extended information about this cigar, but
I'll look it up.
It's very easy to look up, and you can see a picture of it in the show notes. So. Yeah, it was just okay. So, I did like the Epicure number one much better.
Maybe we need a new rating, just okay.
Just okay. Yeah, it was kind of just okay. Yeah,
wouldn't that be the Angler?
I would say so, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I only smoked one, so I wasn't going to trash it. Now, I feel like I'm trashing it if I give it the Angler. I like how we always kind of, we can poke small holes in our rating system if we want to. But this would be one you don't really have to pay attention to pick up on the flavors that are there, kind of thing. So,
I think we all want to be fair. I mean, if you only smoke one cigar, then you gotta.
Put it this way: I liked it enough to not give it the Angler. So
okay.
I also smoked an EP Carrillo Maduro Regalis Real. Is how you say that? This is the Corona type size, 5 5/8 by 46. There was a dark fruit flavor that was overpowered by a bitterness, and I found this is the second Maduro in the EP Carrillo line that I've smoked that just had this kind of like sour bitter flavor that persisted throughout that I wasn't a big fan of, but the underlying flavor was of a nice dark fruity flavor, almost like a dark cherry. It could be the leaf. It just doesn't deliver that nice, smooth smoking experience, and it's frustrating because it has the potential, and EP has certainly the reputation to put out a fantastic smoke, but it just misses the mark. There's something about, I don't know if it's the wrapper or what, but it just doesn't have the balance, and that sourness and bitterness, it ruins it for me every time. So
I definitely like the Coraline Naturals better.
I do too.
Yeah. I'm not a fan of the Maduro.
The Coraline Robustos are awesome. I have a box of those. They're awesome.
Yeah, they're
awesome.
They're really good.
Yeah.
Quickly, the 46 and the 50 is a
ring gauge.
Is a ring gauge.
Yeah. Excellent. So this is a Connecticut broadleaf wrapper, Ecuadorian Sumatra binder, and a Dominican and Nicaraguan filler, and the strength is medium. I had it as a 2.5. Try one, see if you like it. This one had probably at least a year worth of age on it. I went back and I revisited it after I had some time on it, and I still am not a big fan. So, Tim, you had one more. One of my favorite Lanceros. Yeah, Lanceros on your list.
So this was on my list of things I cannot stop smoking, and it's the 100 Años Lancero from La Aurora. Love it. What a versatile smoke. Any time of the day, morning, noon, night. We've talked about it before. What else can I say? I think we're all in agreement. It is a great smoke.
Yeah, you know, absolutely. That in the...
I love the blend.
Yeah.
Personally.
The blend is very dynamic.
Except for the Corona. Coronas were all kind of crappy, but other than that, they were all really good.
You know, it's interesting. That in the Paul Gamarian Reserva Exclusiva Grand Panatella, you take those Lanceros, man, and that will make you fall in love with Lanceros. Like, if you're not a big fan of Lanceros and you smoke either of those two cigars... You'll just be wowed. I mean, they are some of the best Lanceros I've ever smoked in my entire life. Sure. And they deliver consistently each time.
Now, the 100 Años Robusto, I've had a lot of those too, and they kind of hit or miss on me. It's like 50-50. One will smoke great, one will be off. One will smoke great, one will be off. But the Lances, they're always on for me. I got to be honest, every time I come down there, I buy a few more from Stogie Santa because...
Absolutely.
It's so hard to find, and
I like the Lancero, the Preferido, and the Belicoso. Those were really
good. The Belicoso is pretty good too.
I haven't had the Belly yet.
Yeah, it's good.
They're good. Very good.
I have some kicking around my humidor, Tim. We'll trade up for those.
Cool.
I smoked a Arturo Fuente Hemingway Short Story Maduro, something I'm sure we've talked about in the past.
Homer Simpson.
Yeah, you can see the epic ash that I've got on this stick. These are good. I mean, these just pour flavor, awesome construction, awesome burn. It's like one of those no-nonsense short smokes. They just deliver every time. They're full of flavor. They don't change up a whole lot. But the flavors they deliver.
You know what?
Are,
you don't want it to either.
Yeah, because the flavor is so good. It delivers in all departments. It's a no-brainer, box-worthy purchase. I mean, when you've got that half hour, 45 minutes, I would say try and make it 45 minutes, not a half an hour, and just grab it in the box today whenever
it's,
you can.
It's hard for me to make it to 45 minutes with those because they're so damn good. I don't want to stop smoking them.
Yeah, tasty, man.
They are.
Yeah.
I also smoked an Opus X Taurus the Bull from 2007, and this one came in the 2010, they call the story?
2011.
The 2011 is the Maduro one.
No, they made two in 2011, actually, I believe.
Did they?
Yeah.
This one, my box said 2010 on it.
Did it?
Yeah.
Oh, mine says 2011.
We can go look at my humidor. I'm pretty sure that this is a brown color, not black.
Yep.
Or no, this is black, not brown. Sorry. I don't know. It came out of one of those. So it's got the 2007 on the band. The first two-thirds were outstanding. It's nice, sweet, Opus flavor, hints of leather, very smooth, poured smoke. The finish in the final third was just okay. It wasn't too strong. I think the kind of larger ring gauge on this one, I think, helps take down some of the strength. It wasn't over the top, certainly. Very enjoyable first two-thirds. And like I said, the final third kicked up in strength, but didn't deliver as well in the flavor department, in my opinion. So overall, I wasn't wowed. It certainly wasn't the worst of the Opus X. Certainly wasn't the best. Probably somewhere in between. From similar story boxes, this one, I believe, was from the newer one, the 2011 story box. This is the Don Arturo Gran Anniversario, the Sun Grown. This had a black band on the foot, was in cedar, has the band that has the picture of Don Arturo.
Gorgeous band.
The band is like, yeah, it's got to be the most, the band is the most beautiful work of art in a cigar band you've probably ever seen in your life. Yep. Very ornate, very well done. I wish that the flavors in this cigar could have lived up to the band, because this one just needed age. I mean, the youngness, you could definitely taste youngness on it and didn't deliver in the flavor department. I'm saying try one. I mean, I'd hate to buy one of these and let it age for a year, but I think you need to buy one of these and let it age for a year, because it was not a very enjoyable experience, which is too bad, because they retail for $159 for four cigars. Right, you get typically in the different years in these little story boxes, they're called, right? You get two of these Don Arturo Fuente Gran Anniversario smokes. One's usually a Sun Grown, one's usually a Rosado with the red band on the foot.
Which is the one we smoked together, I think.
Yes, and that was very good, actually. Yeah. I like that way better than this one. You get a what's the other shorter Robusto one you get in there? The
Don Carlos.
A Don Carlos limited edition. Yeah. A limited edition Don Carlos, which are very good. I haven't smoked the ones out of either of these. And you get one of them is a Maduro Torres the Bull. One of them is a natural Torres the Bull, I believe, is what's included with those. I haven't smoked the Maduro one yet. It's on my short list because it just looks awesome. So. I also had a Monte Cristo number 2. Now, this one was really weird. You can see it in the picture. So after I clipped the foot off of the cigar, or the head, rather, off the cigar, I didn't clip the foot. I clipped the head. So I clipped the head, and there was like this piece of like straw like inside the cigar. I think it was part of the material they used to like hold the bales together. Or something.
That's bizarre.
It wasn't hair, because we burned it and it did not smell like hair. Because that's what I thought. It looked like hair. Like, if you saw it, you'd be like, oh my God, someone like lost some hair and rolled it in my cigar. It wasn't hair. We burned it. It smelled nothing like hair. It was like it kind of smelled like a straw hay when you put fire to it. And we pulled the whole length of it out. It wasn't quite the full length of the cigar. But it was weird. I was like, you know, I'm smoking it anyway. As long as it's not someone's hair, I'm smoking it, right? it didn't affect the flavor or the taste at all. It was a Monte Cristo number 2. I mean, I've smoked probably full box of these in my lifetime, and it was a Monte Cristo number 2. It wasn't very pronounced in the flavor department. The flavors were kind of muted compared to some of the other Monte number 2s, but I find them to be a little inconsistent, so...
Now, the Monte number 2s, how would you rate them? Medium full?
I'd say they're medium. Well, they're more medium full when you first get them, and the strength tends to dissipate a little bit. And they're, I mean, you could take one. I've taken them down in the morning before.
I'm going to throw this out here because I've never had a Monte 2. If somebody is willing to trade me a Monte 2, I will give them a daisy cutter for it.
Okay. No, yeah.
Okay.
I wouldn't go that far.
Nobody's going to give you money.
Done.
I'll give you 2.
Yeah. I would take 2 because they tend to be inconsistent.
Yeah, I'll give you 2.
I would smoke both before you make your judgments on them.
Yeah, I'll give you 2 for that. That's for sure.
All right. Deal. Done.
They are really good.
I've never had one. And it's one of those things, you know, with Cubans, you don't want to buy a whole box of something before you try it. So unless you can get in on a split or something,
yeah,
it's, you know.
The last one here on my list was a Fuente Opus X Corona. Now, this is one where I definitely have like bags, Ziploc bags with dates written on them of the Opus that I buy.
Fuente size? Is that what it's called?
This is the... A lot of them say Fuente. Right? It's weird. I find a lot of the Opus say Fuente on the gold writing on the cellophane.
Yeah, but it is
this one.
Box.
Yeah, this one they typically refer to the Corona size as the Fuente.
Right.
I've always been
confused
by that because I'll get a larger size and it'll say Fuente on the gold writing on the cellophane.
Because that's the name of the cigar.
Yeah, and nowhere else do they reference that except really on the cellophane, but this is typically referred to as the Fuente size. And it was awesome. This is from 2011. December 2011 is the bag I pulled it out of. And it was awesome.
Yeah,
I haven't even let it age a full year. And although I had every intention to, I couldn't wait because I was in the mood for kind of a smaller opus size smoke. And I went and I pulled it probably sooner than I normally do. Nice punch of strength, balanced with spice. Nice tobacco, sweet tobacco flavor. Really impressed me. Very smokable. The crack in the last third really sucked. There was a huge crack in the wrapper. And as I got down to the final third, it opened up a lot more. And it started, the whole wrapper started to come off on me. I mean, I expect more from... the Opus X in terms of construction, especially for the price. So that was kind of the one drawback to the smoke. However, I mean, this thing delivered. It was awesome. It was an awesome smoke. I like this better, I think, than the Taurus the Bull, which is interesting.
Okay.
It was delivered more in the flavor department.
I could easily see that because it's up there towards the top of my favorite sizes.
It delivers in the flavor department, and the strength doesn't overpower the flavors, which sometimes happens when you smoke Opus.
Now, when
sometimes
it comes to Opus X, this is one I can actually comment on because I've had quite a few of them.
Yeah.
And I can say the love affair that you've given me, quite a few of those, are much better than these.
Oh, yeah.
This is my opinion. But
yeah. The love affair really even kicks down the strength of it, a little more and kind of almost ups it a little more in the flavor department.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah. The different sides of Opus are completely different.
I agree. Very interesting.
Almost actually. Like a different lot. Almost like a totally different blend they put in their different sizes.
And the Fuente Fuente is a 5 5/8 by 46. So yeah, that would be a Corona, Corona Xer, I guess.
Yeah. Really, I mean, these are box worthy. Certainly, you should have a box of these. So that rounds out. How is everyone? You know what? We'll take a break because we've been rambling on and on for a long time now. And we'll take a short break, come back, and we're going to do a segment on maintaining and acquiring large cabinet-style humidors. And we're going to give you kind of our probably final thoughts today on the Quesada Jalapa. So we'll be right back.